Welcome, everyone. This is session three of our workshop series called Growth and Scaling, and it's primarily for CEOs that are $1 million plus in revenue and have achieved product market fit. But it may be also appropriate for consultants and coaches and others that want to enhance their business experience. We're going to do a series of 12 of these, and each has a different theme. Today's theme is on processes and process management, and we're going to review 32 different processes, believe it or not, that every company needs to be ready to scale. The first couple of minutes will be just a backgrounder and may be redundant if you've attended these sessions before. Just a quick bio on me. I spent the first 8 years of my career as a technologist, ending it as VP of Engineering and Chief Technical Officer at Thomson Financial Services, which is today Thomson Reuters. And then I started a career as 14 years as a serial entrepreneur, during which I founded 4 businesses and created an average of $71 million in equity valuation over that 14 years for a little over $1 billion total. Just while I was there, if I added up the value of those companies today, it would be many times that. And that generated a 25x return on average for my investors during that second phase of my career, and well over $10 billion in sales. I can't keep track of it, and it wouldn't be fair because of mergers and acquisitions and our other different things that happened. But there's probably $10 billion, you know, in sales annually from the companies that I started over the years. It's just impossible to track, really, because of M&A. I'm the creator of the CEO Bootcamp, which I started in 2004, and we've trained thousands of CEOs from 40 countries at that event. It went online in 2019, and you can now get the CEO Bootcamp certification at ceobootcamp.us or at our other website with all our training, entrepreneurshipu.com. I'm sorry, yeah, entrepreneurshipview.com, that's correct. I've taken 2 companies from raw startup to $100 million in sales and $156 million. And I've published about close to 500 videos now. We've worked with 40 different industries in the 20 some odd years I've run my consulting and advising companies, posted and published 200 articles, about 6 books, on startups and scaling and management science primarily. And in my free time, I race yachts, I scuba dive, I like to travel when I can, and I enjoy museums and also investing or finance. So today we're going to talk about scaling. And most people know that, you know, around 80 to 85%, probably more, of startups don't become successful, profitable companies, and they close within the first 4 to 5 years. But what most people don't know is that only 1 in 400 companies will reach just $10 million in sales, so 0.25%, and only about 1 in 6,300 will reach $100 million in sales, so 0.02% will reach that level. The odds are really stacked against you, and it's a high hill to climb. So statistically speaking, it's 1,260 times harder to get a company to 100 million than it is to build a profitable startup. These figures are primarily from independent research by nonprofit companies. But our focus at AirTight Management is helping any company get there. I'm a firm believer that you can make any company a billion-dollar company, because a company is just a legal entity that you put products and services into, right? And so if you continue to innovate and develop new products and services, any company can, you know, theoretically grow forever. But what we focus on is getting our clients to 25% plus sustainable growth and maybe as much as 100% compound growth. Obviously, some companies can go faster than that, but it's the rare exception. And that will 10x a company's size in 5 years. But 5 years at 100% compound annual growth rate winds up being a 32x of the company. And we'll show you some of the math in a table for reference of that. And you know, of course, that 32x could become 64x 1 year later if you can sustainably grow at 100%. AirTight Management is really only for companies with 1 million plus sales who have found their product market fit. And probably by the time you get to 30 million, you've figured most of this stuff out. That's not to say everyone does everything they should and the processes and systems they have internally, but they're obviously doing well in the market if they've hit that $30 million market and they've figured out most everything they need to grow. Now, there's no official definition of scaling, but for our purposes and in our curriculum, we define scaling as growing at about 25% plus. And so this is what this looks like. Normal growth is sort of from 5%, which would barely keep up with inflation and would have gone behind inflation in the last couple of years, to 24%. And that's not as hard because you're kind of not having to rebuild and reorganize and change things constantly. If you're scaling and growing at that 25% plus, the drain on the team and the equity and the need to hire and train new people, bring in capital and many other things makes it exponentially more difficult. And of course, the absolute numbers are getting bigger and bigger every year. So there's an exponential acceleration there. You're going to have problems attracting sophisticated investors. And we have a slide on that coming up in a minute, because they're looking for that compound annual growth rate and outsized returns. And companies with, you know, what they'll call a secret sauce, or some people call it a moat. We like to call it a sustainable competitive advantage. And there are many, many ways that a company can add sustainable competitive advantage, and that will directly impact their recurring revenue and the price to earnings ratio that they can exit that company at. But, you know, growth is fine, and many businesses that are commodities or local geographically, you know, that's all they should ever try to do. Scaling is not for everybody. But if you're going to scale, you've got to shift styles and management gears and stretch timelines and planning and hire better people and do all kinds of different things. And there's no magic wand or single thing. It's about adapting constantly, innovating constantly. And there's hundreds, literally hundreds of things you should do. And that's what this workshop series is about. It's trying to point out those things that CEOs and founders don't know they don't know, because they don't know it's a problem until they hit it in the marketplace. And oftentimes they don't understand the root cause of the problem because they see the symptom as opposed to the problem itself. So, you know, to attract investors and to attract the best employees, you want to be a scaling company. And that essentially becomes a bit of a self-fulfilling prophecy, because if you can attract a lot of capital and you can attract the best people and put those things together, you know, you're going to have a much easier time growing. Now, this is a diagram that I'm surprised hasn't been put out there by others. I've never seen it except the one I've created here in this format. But essentially, it shows the scales on the x-axis of differentiation and on the y-axis of protectability. And any venture capitalist, or really any smart investor, wants the maximum of both of those, which would put people up in that top right column there. Oh, I gotta get this off the screen. There we go. So what's gonna happen is a commodity business is not a scalable company. You don't have enough profit margin to fund growth and innovation. And so it's staying alive and managing your costs. Michael Porter, the father of strategy, you know, has a diagram of this, you know, where they talk about the five forces and the four quadrants that you have a company in. And he talks about this, but not in this same format. A scalable company, a company starts to be a little more scalable when you're more competitive in the marketplace. And scaling will eat capital. It's, you know, kind of a law of the universe that if you're going to grow, you need to add capital to your working capital. It's going to be necessary just to fund the assets and the time frames and the various things that happen as you scale. And then a distinct company, someone that has a real serious competitive advantage, or like I said, a secret sauce, that company is able to scale at 50 to 100%. And then breakthrough, you know, the unicorns you hear about, you know, the Facebooks of the world and the Googles, which are, you know, the one in a million companies, really, they can scale at over 100%, but they're going to have lots of problems and they're going to need to hire top people to help them do that. I have failed to ever find any scaled company that didn't go out and hire, frankly, gray-haired help from people to be able to maintain that level of growth, because the dilution and the stress and the planning required, you know, you're building a car as you're going down the highway very rapidly. So you need to have an advanced team of managers that have some scaling experience. And of course, that are expert in the five key areas of business: marketing, sales, finance, product development, whatever your industry is, and operations. So if you want to be scalable, you've really got to be under that oval there, and you can move to the right and up in this diagram. We will work with commodity companies occasionally, and we tend to work more with competitive to move them right and up. And that happens by adding a culture of innovation and continuing to create new and better products. So it's sort of a natural law of entrepreneurship that, you know, sort of like gravity, that if you want to scale, you've got to have some distinct or breakthrough products. And here's the math of this. I won't read this to you, but you can screenshot it and think about it. This is essentially, if you start with a $2 million company, this is the factor on current sales, and this is the actual dollars that that company will be at each of these rates of scaling. And so if you look at this, you know, of course, investors want to be here in the rapid growth companies. And so a venture capitalist is probably not going to invest in you if they don't think you can hit 50% compound annual growth rate. And smart managers are certainly founders and C-level people that understand the economics of business are going to want companies that have that capability. And that's why every venture capitalist looks for a financial projection or a pro forma that's showing the expected growth rate. And I personally believe that you can grow at any rate you set you want, as long as you plan for it, have the capital and have the people and the recruiting and the training done to be able to do that. You can throttle the growth of your business as long as you're planning it a year or more in advance to have the appropriate staff for that rate of growth. So Jim Collins, I guess recently, has probably become my favorite author. It used to be Malcolm Gladwell, the author of Blink and a bunch of others. But, you know, every book I read, I'm just finishing now Beyond Entrepreneurship, which came out a few years back. And once again, Jim Collins sort of hits it out of the park. And so I recommend all his books to every entrepreneur. You know, their high-level philosophy of building businesses that can become great and grow and scale rapidly. So definitely recommend you you read all of these books or get them on audio, as I do. I listen to books when I walk my dog twice a day with Audible. And most of these, the bestsellers, of course, are available on Audible as well as in text format. But I, like I said, I think you can grow a company any size if you, as Jim says, get the right people on the bus and have them in the right seats. And what he doesn't talk about, which is what AirTight Management solves, is dropping in the pre-built systems. a conclusion that Jim made of his study of over 200 companies in good to great was it took the average great company 8 to 10 years to figure out their internal systems. And that's not intuitive or obvious. It's a lot of trial and error. And essentially, that's why we created AirTight Management. You know, we drop in generic systems and we tune them and customize them for the business, which is only 10 or 15% different. And so we can cut many years off the setup to scale. So we're talking today about process management. And here's a definition I got out of ChatGPT. I won't read it all to you, but it seems more obvious, you know, that the definition ought to be obvious, but that's the easy part. Knowing what it is, of course, is very different than executing it well. And, you know, the constant improvement and the Kaizen or the Kanai, constant and never-ending improvement philosophy, is what's enabled by having good process management and documentation. And so we're going to talk about what's behind the curtain and deeper in that, and give you a list of all the processes that are appropriate to build out before you start scaling at 50 or 100%, because you're going to have all kinds of firefighting and problems if you don't start building that foundation before you start to grow at that rate. So process management in its simplest form is shown in this diagram. You design a process, you model and test it, and then you begin executing it. You monitor it, and that can be had with KPIs or performance ratios or statistics. And then you continually optimize it, knowing the world changes and things change. And so nothing's ever final, and you do want to continue to optimize. But the simplest way to look at a company is a collection of people plus processes plus assets. The assets might be land or capital, working capital, or all kinds of other things, intellectual property or whatever. But process is required. And in fact, it's one of the better ways to have your secret sauce and your barriers to entry by keeping those processes internally that you're optimizing and putting a lot of blood, sweat, and tears into secret. And that can be done with copyrights and documentation and training and non-disclosure agreements with your employees so that they're not taking all your best hard-earned ideas to your competitors. Process management needs no software. Of course, there's plenty of people that are happy to sell you software to do it, but I'm actually 100% against implementing philosophy and procedures before, or not implementing those before you go into hard coding them essentially, or configuring them in software. It's much better to train and have a convention to start and then configure it in software later when the scale is appropriate, but definitely not start out and let the software define the processes. That's sort of the tail wagging the dog. And the culture is more important than the software. And when you install software and go through installing an ERP or other complex systems, you're essentially letting software people define your philosophy and your principles and other things. And that's not a good idea. So you want to implement process before you implement software to manage process. It only requires a convention, and we'll talk about that a little bit today, is actually pretty simple. Kaizen, or the Japanese word for constant improvement, is enhanced by having a visual diagram or a flow chart, and that allows discussion of it, because a picture is worth 1,000 words. It not only documents it, it sets it up for training, and it sets it up for analysis and optimization, which opens the door to innovation. Because when you have a diagram and you can point to it and talk about it, you're not missing on communications things that might not come out well in words that can be shown in pictures and diagrams better. It eliminates ambiguity. Preparing to scale takes years. Like I said, Jim Collins would tell you 8 to 10 years, although I think we've broken that that sound barrier, if you will, by having generic systems that can be dropped in. But this is because of having to build processes, build training, form culture, have a culture of innovation. These are the things that take years to perfect. And of course, even listening to customers, that's one of the processes we're going to talk about in our list today. And what I don't hear people saying, and isn't in the definition of process, is there must be ownership of process. So that's what creates accountability and a desire and responsibility for innovation and enhancing that process and thinking about it constantly. So any given process should be owned by one person, not a department. A person should be responsible for the ownership of that process. And it's not always a manager. You know, if it's a shop floor or a manufacturing thing, you want to push that process ownership down to the people that do it every day because they understand it lots better. I could tell lots of stories about that, but we don't have that kind of time today. Now, what's a process versus a standard operating procedure? You know, an SOP is very simple and fast. A process is generally more complex. If it's a checklist of less than 7 items, I'd probably call it an SOP, not a process. A process requires some, potentially some judgment. It's not black and white or objective completely. There's generally some decisions that need to be made to branch. So other differences between SOP. An SOP sort of stays the same. You know, it's a, think of it as a simple checklist and easy instructions maybe that could fit on one page. But a process is going to have many variations, tree branches, and like I said, judgment is required when you have those choices that must be made. An SOP is pretty low risk because it's usually visible. You can see what's wrong with it because of its simple nature. And, you know, sometimes cause and effect are separated in time and space. There's a great book on that called The Learning Organization by Peter Senge, which explains what most consultants learn, that typically the root problem is 2 or 3 levels away from the symptom. And so that's a problem in debugging processes and designing processes. So you know, when those things get hidden in layers or in other departments that the people executing it may not have control over, you have a lot of risk and those things can explode and cause problems later. The ISO organization, you know, actually has standards for processes, but most of these are too complex and expensive to be implemented by smaller businesses that we work with that are 100 or 200 people. And those standards tend to be for manufacturing companies more than the general company in the world. So, like I said, UGG process, people hate the word process because it implies boring, it implies bureaucracy, right? But no company can scale without systemization, which effectively is another name for process, right? You've got to have continuous process management, documentation, and optimization, or a process to optimize the process, right? It's that discipline and coming back and looking at it that creates an innovative culture. So, you know, I already said this quote, doing what everyone else, you know, hates to do well is really what separates the winners from the losers sometimes. Everyone knows the do it. And by do it, I mean, what is your secret sauce that you do, which generates most of the value for your customers? You know, that's the most obvious process in your business. And probably everyone knows that and is constantly thinking about it because it's sort of where the rubber hits the road and why customers come to you, right? But thinking about that process, you want to hide a lot of it if you can and not broadcast it to the world because it is, that's why it's called your secret sauce, right? There's going to be hard learning, as I said earlier, that blood, sweat, and tears goes into, and you don't want to broadcast that to everyone else in the world to take your experience and use it against you. Copyrighted training manuals is a good example of that. Many The processes have embedded elements, trade secrets, algorithms, siloed information. Many organizations break things up just so they're not teaching all their employees how to do everything and spin off and be a competitor. I mean, that's what's wrong with the real estate industry, right? Every broker, the company doesn't provide that much value, and every broker is able to run the business. And so you're always in the process of training your competitors and spinning out more competitors. And that's not a good business to be in. That creates a commodity and pure service environment with no trade secrets or formula that gives you differentiation in the marketplace, which is probably the most important word, is differentiation and building businesses. We teach that at our CEO bootcamp. Complexity is good here because each layer or value you can add in that process is creating more value for your competitor or for your customers, rather, and maybe not something your competitors are doing. One secret that I learned back at Thompson, you know, in the 1980s was own and control the language. By bringing customers along with your methods of thinking, your model, your process, the competitors that are trying to displace you when they're pitching will sound like they're speaking Greek. And if you've trained them on your models and your way of thinking, it makes it much more difficult for competitors to take business away from you. And obviously that language and that model is, you know, hopefully more sophisticated and more value added for the customer as well. And constantly looking for ways to innovate and improve, that word Kaizen is enabled by having some focus and some resources to process optimization. So you don't find, you know, great chefs publishing their recipes unless they're selling it in books, and they're probably reserving their best restaurants, you know, or best recipes for their own restaurants, right? They're not going to give away all their secret sauce, and every business should be like that because we've got to protect what we invest in building. And that's, you know, sort of a fiduciary duty of every officer and even a manager in a company. So the customer feedback loop is a process that I find a lot of young companies don't do. They'll think they've done it if they have a complaint mailbox or a physical box in the lobby for, you know, employees and or customers to put suggestions in. But the suggestion box doesn't cut it. You've got to have a formalized institutional feedback loop. And as a company grows and has more layers of bureaucracy, information tends to get sugar-coated, and this allows dishonesty and politics to grow. Jeff Bezos requires all executives to spend some time listening to phone conversations with customers and spending time where, you know, the rubber hits the road with the customer execution and delivery. And this is essentially a large company version of management by wandering around. It's forcing the executives down. And so not only do you need that customer feedback loop to go across all the levels of the business and to be objective and independent, but you've got to make sure that managers and executives are spending some time looking at that data. And you really should have separate processes for regular customer complaints versus escalation. I find when I deal with customer service issues, oftentimes not knowing when to escalate and not having a higher level of training and the next person get it. You know, they're beating their heads on a problem and it's way beyond them. And, you know, as a CTO and VP of engineering, what I call a technical support line, it's very frustrating to be, talking to someone in India that's reading a script and has absolutely no understanding of what you're dealing with. And eventually that's going to come back and bite that company in the butt and be a problem. And this customer feedback loop being institutionalized will help with that. Separately, an employee feedback loop is the next process we're going to talk about. And that's making all employees, including executives and managers, accountable, but not just accountable to their boss, accountable to the corporate values, accountable to the staff under them, accountable to the peers that they have to support in other departments across the organization where they may have internal customers, accountable to results, which is a dashboard or KPIs. Most processes should have inputs and outputs and therefore essentially productivity ratios or success ratios associated with them. And if there's enough volume of those and enough cost associated with it, those metrics should be tracked in a dashboard. And of course, you know, employees have to be accountable for budgets as well. Next process we're going to talk about, and we talked about this a little earlier, is lead generation. Everyone's seen the funnel of moving from marketing, or sometimes they're called suspects, to prospects, and then down that funnel to more serious and serious companies and prospects until you get an actual win or opportunity closed. Lead generation is probably the number one process that you've got to figure out and have numbers for as soon as you have your product entering the market. You must understand the cost of each lead. I'm amazed when I talk to companies and, you know, sometimes their VP of marketing or their CEO doesn't even know what a lead is costing them. And it's so important to have that circle. It's a vicious circle if your lead cost is exceeding your overall economics for the business and profitability. And so I've seen businesses where their lead cost is greater than their actual profit on the sale. And obviously that's not sustainable. You must be able to quantify all of these. This is just a random sample funnel. You know, you can find a million of these online. But the point is that every company ought to have its definition and its language and how many layers. And just like any process, each layer on this funnel has to have a process associated with it to get people from one level in the funnel to the next level. And that should be quantified and measured whenever possible. And that creates that conversion rate that you see here. The magic is in the targeting, and most businesses are going to be successful based on the selection of their market. I've seen many businesses killed because they do not select the right market. So strong companies, you know, need multiple lead sources, and, you know, that process may be a little different from each of those channels in figuring out who are the best leads. Because if you pass on a lot of bad leads to a sales team, which is very expensive, you're going to be wasting a lot of resources. So many companies fail by just choosing the wrong target market or go-to-market strategy. They don't find and rank the best niche or target market. Lead qualification is the next type kind of process we're going to talk about. That's different than getting the lead in the funnel, right? Now you're ranking that lead, and they've got to have these characteristics. Again, these diagrams are just for samples. I do recommend most processes have a flow chart with text and comments on the notes, and have an owner that's responsible for writing and updating those, as well as those tools are used, of course, for training. So the criteria for lead qualification, generically, it's going to be different for you, and it's going to be much more specific to your product and your industry, is have the ability to buy or the budget, has the decision authority. The Miller-Hyman process for large account management and selling is very good, which talks about four archetypes of different people, because oftentimes there's a committee making decisions on large sales, and you have to talk to each of those four different archetypes. And if I remember right, they're the economic buyer, i.e. who signs the check and owns the budget. There's the user buyer, the user of the product. There's the influencer, which tends to be someone of authority internally and maybe a technical person representing the company and looking at sort of the technical specs. And then there's the champion, and the champion is often the person that brings you into the company, likes and understands your product, and is working with you to sell it internally. So obviously that, though, having those four people identified can be one of your lead qualification processes. That's typically for a big sale, $50,000, $100,000 and up, that you have that level of sophistication in your lead qualification. They have a pain or a problem, and ideally, if you can quantify how big that problem is, that allows you to feed them back an ROI, which all the higher ups in an organization should want to see. And then you've got to ask, is it the right time? You know, oftentimes there are things going on internally that will prevent new initiatives, whether it's budget or people time, you know, or the CEO just changed, or the division manager just changed. You know, there's a sale, there's a merger and acquisition. I mean, these are things that, you know, 20-30% of the time, long sales cycles will get killed by things that happen that are out of the control of the salespeople, for example. And of course, you can solve their problem. I mean, I like to solution sell, which is diagnosing the person's problem and making sure very early on that you're one of the best solutions for them, because that's a win-win and it's going to provide more value and a much higher closing ratio. So obviously that's a really great qualification to look at. Are you the best person for them? If someone walks into a Porsche dealer, you know, and they don't have the budget, or they're not interested in sportiness, you know, obviously both of those people are sort of wasting their time, and you're better off referring that person to another brand or another dealer. And lastly, you know, they can understand your solution. I find the more complex your product is, the more you're going to run into problems where the lack of sophistication and knowledge and not working with the right people is going to kill the deal and prevent a closure. And so those are sort of six generic things that should be in a lead qualification process. And strong companies are clearly going to have very strict guidelines, because salespeople are not analytical people. They're people people. They're more, you know, more right-brained than left-brained, or left-brained than right-brained, because they're not good at doing math and figuring this out. They're, you know, they're people people, not numbers people. The sales process. Now, everyone knows this, and I've added all these pluses in here because we're kind of going through, you know, what is a typical sales process and the layers, and talking about breaking it down. Each one of these colored slices is really a different process, right? And you can continue to bifurcate things in here more, and you'll probably have to do that as the company grows. But the important thing is that sales must have a process that is appropriate to that product, that price point, that target buyer. A lack of follow-up is one of the main reasons that leads go cold. And, you know, I see these statistics from many sources, but, you know, this is the one I thought was the simplest and the best to talk about today. You know, 80% of sales are made on the 5th to 12th contact, and people stop contacting after 2 or 3. So it is the disciplined salesperson that continues to work the client, sometimes even when they say no, that's going to be most successful. And a lot of people lack the sales discipline as well as the analytical skills. You've got to give them this process. If they were able to figure it out themselves, they wouldn't be a salesperson. They'd be a VP of sales or a sales consultant or something else. Salespeople are not good. I have, in the past, I have doubled the business in a company, in one case of a client, by cutting the number of leads given to the salespeople in half. That may seem counterintuitive, but when you understand that all a salesperson does is play a broken record and go at people, and the more leads they have, the more they're going to do that, the less thinking they're doing about qualifying their customers and spending more time on the best prospects. That's why a lot of CRM systems today have ranking and prioritization systems, and even economically rank the prospect and the total amount in the pipeline to be watched. Next, I think we'll skip this because we haven't got enough people to get a statistically significant answer on that, Tajveer. Customer onboarding is a process. This is one that sometimes people ignore. Just simply breaking it down to delivery, post-delivery, the training of the customer to make sure they can use the product well, the success management. I know there's a lot of companies now have a success manager that is in charge of that customer having everything they need to be successful using the product. Obviously, you've got to have the right economics to be able to afford this. But with automation, you can do some level of this with most people today. Getting testimonials from customers, so important today, especially with social media, to take those things and feed them back onto your website and social media when you have happy customers. So all of these things should be part of an onboarding process. And note that, with an online sale and e-commerce, the UX, is this whole customer onboarding process potentially. But many companies, most companies, it's not just that simple, and you need a lot of thinking about the onboarding process. Some of them are going to be super simple, with just a linear set of steps and you're done. They're very transactional. Here's one I pulled up just off the internet of, a much more complex onboarding flowchart, of course. Depending on how much they're spending, this is likely to correlate very well to how much onboarding you've got to do to ensure they're going to be successful and, they're going to refer other customers and come back for more. Strategy related processes, I'm going to start listing these and not going into the detail as much because we have 32 processes we're listing for you today to think about as a checklist to determine if you're ready to scale. Strategic planning, I would argue, is the most complex process in the business because it involves all the disciplines: marketing, sales, finance, product development, operations, legal issues, governance issues. It's really the highest level and most variables in a process. That's why we do strategic planning as part of our consulting. The product development cycle, obviously very key to ensure that you're innovating. We have a product development process that we teach in one of our courses, which I created, which is similar to the Lockheed Martin Skunk Works. I found out after I invented mine that they were doing a lot of the same things that I had to come up with independently in the early 80s when I was in product development. Product design cycle. I mean, I have a very phased approach to this as well. Most companies do not spend enough time in the design of the product because this, in the case of software engineers, they want to start coding right away. And that's like building a bridge, on the first day and showing up with all the steel, but no plans, right? So that's not a good starting point. And the magic really happens in the iteration of the design process. That's what drives innovation. Your product release cycle should be a process. This is a lot of companies have been killed by doing a bad product release cycle that taints their brand for the long term, blows up their system, ruins their reputation. So obviously, the bigger you get and the harder it is to run the systems and the more people you have, the more risk you have and the more you've got to think about this. Here's a kind of a free sample. This is our the high level view of what we do for strategic planning in three phases. And, you can screenshot this and think about it, but this is how we facilitate a strategic planning process. And of course, there's a much more detailed checklist for each of these boxes in the flowchart, but that's the whole point of having flowcharts, is it makes you think about the steps and repeatability of these processes. Here's the list of topics that we'll be discussing next in session 3 and beyond up to 12. As you know, today is about team, and these are the subjects the next session. These are the first Wednesday of the month at 4 p.m. CT if you want to attend the live session. But of course, we're recording all the sessions, and if you have signed up and purchased the package, you'll have access to all the full recordings. We try to do that within a day or two. Sometimes they need a little editing and it takes a little longer, but they will certainly be available a few business days after the live session, and that way you can take notes again, redo them. We encourage people to bring their senior employees to understand these challenges, because so few people have been through a rapidly scaling company. If you have a $1 million company and you're the CEO, we will have a free strategy session for you. And we can talk about doing an audit to find out your weakest spots that you may not be aware of that are holding your scaling efforts back. Thanks a lot for attending. I'm Bob Norton, and we'll see you in the next session. Bye-bye.